Just My Luck by Jane Shepts. Published by Author House and narrated by Hannibal Hills. I would like to thank all my friends who told me their embarrassing stories. I couldn't have written this book otherwise. It would have never occurred to me that situations like these are possible. That is to say, every situation described in this book happened to someone, somewhere. Prologue. A sparrow flew through an open window and landed on a parapet. It looked around. The rays of sun were shining through the open window on an empty office. Two tables were standing back to back with each other in the center of the room. One table had one leg that was shorter, which the owner had solved by placing a thick book underneath it. Most of the front cover was illegible, but the words "criminal code" were visible. Both tables were hidden under a pile of papers. On top of them stood two coffee cups with half-drunk coffee and a half-eaten cake. It seemed there were also two computers of older making buried underneath the paperwork. The web in the corner of one of the monitors made it clear it wasn't used intently. Either that, or the owner didn't care about a clean work environment. By the window, there stood a partially open wardrobe. The shelves that were visible contained files. The opposite wall was covered in posters and a blackboard with lots of notes, which couldn't make any sense to anyone anymore. In the corner stood an old dirty fan turning slowly, as if in protest to summer heat. From time to time, a shadow in a human shape walked behind the closed glass door. This and the fan were the only moving things in the otherwise static and quiet room. The sparrow cheeped and flew through the room. It landed by the cake on the table and pecked crumbs. Another sparrow followed the first one into the room, and the first one shrieked in protest. The new arrival landed on the table and puffed its feathers to look bigger. The first sparrow lifted its wings into the air and leaned forward to make its tail appear taller. It hopped forward, but the new arrival didn't get scared at all. It jumped onto the first sparrow, chirruping loudly. The first sparrow jumped back and fell off the table. It flapped its wings and safely landed on the ground. Suddenly, the office door slammed open, and the sparrow on the table fled away through the open window. The first sparrow flew into the air but hit the lift cord of the window's blinds. It changed the direction of its flight rapidly and, in fright, flew onto the wardrobe. It landed on top of the wardrobe and turned to watch the room. A policeman entered the room, leading a handcuffed man by his shoulder. The man was quite tall, with dark brown hair, blue eyes, and an annoyed look on his face. Under the dirty and shabby interior, there was probably once a very handsome man. It seemed like he could use a long shower and a good night's sleep. He was wearing once black jeans, stained with mud and dirt. The jeans were completely wet from the rim all the way up to his knees. His feet were bare in sandals, but it was getting difficult to see the stripes of the sandals against the dirty feet. Both sandals and his feet were a similar yellowish colour that was turning into dark grey. His once white shirt was of yellowish-grey colour. There were sweat marks on the shoulders and under his arms. The rolled-up sleeves were stained with dirt and grass and, on one arm, also by something resembling oil. He had a big brown stain on his belly and long, thin cuts on his right forearm that were still bleeding slightly. His brown hair was greasy and dirty. The mixture caused his hair to stand up in a very strange haircut. There were huge shadows under his eyes, and his face hadn't seen a razor or soap in a few days. The policeman led the man into the empty office and threw him onto the chair by the second table. The man didn't object. He just scowled at the policeman. The policeman turned around and walked to the office door. He didn't even look at the man as he walked outside and closed the door behind him. The man adjusted his hands so that he would not sit on them and then leaned his forehead against the table. The sparrow flew off the wardrobe towards the man. It was trying to get a better angle to get out of the window. As it flew closer to the tables, the man straightened up. The sparrow quickly changed direction and flew towards the window, but was too high. It flew back onto the wardrobe and hid in the far corner. The man looked at the ceiling, surprised. He turned around, and when he noticed the open window, he relaxed and turned to face the tables. The sparrow leaned against the wood and watched the man. Its heart was beating rapidly, but it didn't dare to move. The man sighed and leaned back. The sparrow hopped further away from the edge of the wardrobe. The man sat still for a while, absent-mindedly watching the slowly moving fan in the corner. The sparrow's heartbeat was slowly moving back to its normal, though still rapid, frequency. Suddenly, the man jumped to his feet. The sparrow chirruped in fright and took off, but it hit the ceiling and fell back onto the wardrobe. The man looked up, surprised, and turned to the window. He stood still for a few seconds. Then he shrugged and, carefully, with his hands handcuffed behind his back, pulled out a phone from his back pocket. He turned his back to the table and put the phone down. With his back still turned to the phone, he palpated the power button and turned the phone on. He turned around and looked at the phone. Then he sat down and, using his nose, he poked the phone a few times. "Rats!" he said angrily after a while and straightened up. His eyes were slightly squinting. He blinked a few times and shook his head. With a long sigh, he leaned over the phone once more and continued poking the phone with his nose. The door of the office opened once more, and a man in a shirt and dark suit pants and with a badge on his belt entered the office. He had a passport in one hand and a cup of coffee in the other. He was young and well-built, with very wide shoulders and strong arms. His blonde hair was cut so short that the hairs blended in with the skin on his head and made him look bald. He looked at the handcuffed man by the table with a frown and slammed the door closed with his heel. He walked to the table. "Gabriel James, right?" he asked and put the cup on the table. Gabriel nodded with a brief jerk of his head. The man looked at the passport and flipped a few pages. "I'm Detective Horvath," he added quietly as he sat down on the second chair. He didn't even look up from the passport. "We don't usually arrest Brits here, you know," the detective added in a more bored-sounding voice. Gabriel didn't say anything to that statement. He watched the detective with mild interest as the detective flipped through the pages of Gabriel's passport. Occasionally, the detective stopped on some page and studied it for a longer time. "You haven't really travelled, have you?" the detective asked at last. "Just Greece, a long time ago," he added and flipped another page. Gabriel didn't say anything. "When did you come here?" He looked up from the passport and glared at Gabriel. They stared at each other for a second or two, and then the detective's sight fell on the phone on the table. He frowned and then looked up at Gabriel. "I want to speak to my lawyer," Gabriel said calmly and motioned to the phone. "I have his phone number in my phone." "That won't be necessary," the detective said and put the passport down. "In your own words, you haven't done anything wrong. You're not accused of anything, so you don't need a lawyer." "Then why did you handcuff me?" Gabriel asked calmly. The detective frowned at Gabriel. Gabriel returned his stare without blinking. It looked like a battle of minds. The detective finally broke the stare, content at looking at the phone screen. It was still turned on. The detective folded his arms and slowly lifted his gaze towards Gabriel. "Well, you tried to kidnap a 2-year-old, he said.
"No, I didn't," Gabriel shouted.
"And you attacked the mother of the child."
"Actually, she attacked me."
The detective's eyebrow flew towards his hairline. Gabriel pressed his lips together and took a deep breath through his nose.
"That was all just a misunderstanding," he said calmly. "I want to speak to my lawyer. Here's his name and phone number," Gabriel added and pushed the phone closer to the detective with his nose. The detective picked up the phone with a blank expression and looked at the screen. He palpated the papers on the table until he found a pen. He then wrote the name and the phone number down on one of the many papers on the table. He looked at Gabriel and stood up. "It will take some time for your lawyer to get here," he said with a bored look on his face. Gabriel didn't say anything. The detective picked up the passport and took his cup of coffee. "Meanwhile, you can wait here," he added. He walked out of the office and closed the door behind him, leaving Gabriel alone in the office with the frightened sparrow on the wardrobe. Gabriel sighed and looked around once more. "How the hell did I get here?" he asked the room in general. The sparrow chirruped and flew for the window once more, this time managing to reach it. Chapter 1. 42 hours earlier. Gabriel drove his car through a forest. The drive was smooth, thanks to a new asphalt road. He looked at tall trees around him and noticed the red sunlight of the setting sun on their top branches. The shadow fell on roads and clearings beneath the trees, throwing the forest into twilight. Gabriel wore a bright, clean, white shirt tucked into black jeans. The top button was loose and the sleeves were rolled up to his elbows. He was shaved clean. His dark hair was a little messy, which made him look very dashing. A beautiful woman sat in the passenger's seat. She had long, dark brown hair that fell on her shoulders, covering her cleavage. Her name was Diana, and she was Gabriel's. Well, they'd dated for 3 weeks. Gabriel felt proud to have captured her heart. She was beautiful, smart, and rich. She was definitely out of his league, and he still couldn't believe she was going out with him. "Beautiful country," he said out loud and looked at the woman. She just smiled and shrugged. Gabriel understood this as, "It's all right." Out of the corner of his eye, he spotted something ginger and turned his head towards a fox crouched by a bush near the road. It eyed the car as Gabriel drove by. He continued up the road with no desire to stop and watch the fox. He wasn't that keen on nature. He was willing to admit that seeing a live fox was awesome. He might even write it on his Facebook wall. Well, he would if he cared strongly enough. The phone in the holder on the windscreen showed the road in front of him. The GPS made a beep noise, and a woman's voice announced, "In 100 yards, turn left." Gabriel slowed, and when the GPS announced he should turn, he left the main road. They entered a quiet clearing, and the main asphalt road changed to a gravel one. The car's headlights illuminated the clearing. On one side, a brook flowed calmly around a flower garden and a little summer house. The rest of the clearing was taken up by a huge house. It was a luxury house with 4 bedrooms, 2 living rooms, 3 bathrooms, a huge kitchen, and a dining room. Yet, it was a small cottage to Diana's family. The gravel road led to the house and onto a wider landing, often used as a parking lot. The car slowed until it reached the end of the road. The wheels crunched and came to a halt. Gabriel leaned against the wheel and gaped at the house in front of him. He watched the building for a while and then turned off the engine. The lights went out, and the building was once more thrown into semi-darkness. Gabriel stepped outside and closed the door. He watched the house in awe, completely forgetting about everything else. He whistled. Suddenly, he remembered his passenger, who was still sitting in the car. As he hurriedly approached the passenger's door, he brushed back his hair and put on a bright smile. The door opened just as he reached it, and he watched a slim leg swing onto the gravel. He grabbed the door and opened it more, nearly breaking it off the hinges. Diana stepped out. She was slender and very elegant. The high heels digging into the gravel made her legs look incredibly long. She smiled at Gabriel, who was suddenly very nervous. "Welcome to our humble weekend house," she said, and motioned towards the manor. "I wouldn't call that humble, Diana," Gabriel pointed out and closed the door for her. "I never realized you were this rich."
"I'm not," Diana said as she shook her head. Her smile faded. "My parents are."
A little shadow crossed her face. Gabriel shifted and ran his fingers through his hair. They'd never really talked about her parents. Gabriel had a suspicion there was something more there than met the eye. Maybe being a daughter of very wealthy parents wasn't the fairy tale a lot of people took it for. They stood still for a while, looking at each other. Gabriel wasn't sure what to say. They'd never had any serious conversations before, and he wasn't sure how to start this one. He wanted to find some words of encouragement, but couldn't think of any. Seconds moved on, and he got a feeling he looked like an idiot. He gave her a big smile, but that made him feel even worse. Any second now, she would ask him to take her back to the city. He cleared his throat and hurried towards the trunk of the car. He avoided her look as he opened the trunk. "I am threatened by them right now," he thought, as he put aside the basket with bread, fruits, and vegetable. He peeked at the back seat, where stood a basket with bottles of Coca-Cola and the rest of the food.
"Don't be,"
Diana said calmly, and stepped closer. Gabriel looked at her, surprised. Then he realized that he hadn't thought the last sentence, but had actually said it out loud. She just smiled and leaned into the trunk. Ignoring his befuddled look, she pulled out a small bag with her computer. She looked at him and chuckled when she noticed his look. She quickly changed the laughter to a small cough and picked up her toilet bag. Gabriel finally came to his senses and turned to their luggage. He picked up one suitcase in each hand and put them on the gravel.
"I'm sure they were like you," she added quietly. "I mean, if you ever meet them."
Gabriel knew that she meant this as encouragement, but shivers run down his spine at the idea of meeting her parents. He froze and looked at Diana. He had known her brother for years now, ever since they'd been roommates in college. Gabriel had chosen a university in Bratislava as part of Erasmus program and had found a nice little room in a flat in the centre. There had been three rooms, and Diana's brother, who had been studying law at the time, had lived in one of them. They had become very good friends, and when Gabriel had returned to Bratislava years later, they'd met regularly. However, Gabriel had never met his friend's parents. Now, he wished he had. It would have been much easier meeting them as their son's friend than as their daughter's boyfriend. The good thing was that he and Diana had been together for only 3 weeks, and they hadn't even slept together, so there was no risk of meeting her parents, at least not yet. Then he realized that any meeting that would happen in the near future wouldn't be staged. This was a bit unnerving. With his luck, he would meet them while running to the bathroom in the middle of the night, and he would be naked. He suppressed the image and took a basket with food from the trunk. Wordlessly, he closed the trunk, picked up their luggage in one hand, and followed Diana to the cottage with the basket in the other. As he walked up the gravel road, he tried to remember anything about her parents. A memory of Diana's brother showing him a picture of himself and his father flashed in front of Gabriel's eyes. The head of their family was a tall and strong man, and he had 4 Rottweilers. Gabriel tried to push the memory aside and hardly noticed when Diana unlocked and opened the door. She cleaned her shoes on a mat by the door and entered. Gabriel mimicked her as he walked into the darkness of the living room. Diana found a switch and turned on the lights. Gabriel whistled and put the bags down. A small anteroom led directly to the living room, which was 2 stories tall and very spacious. A magnificent fireplace was on one side and a huge flat-screen TV on the other. The wooden floor and the wooden railings on the second floor stood out against the marble mantelpiece and white walls. The furniture was luxurious and fit the place perfectly. There was a huge white sofa with 2 white armchairs around a big glass table. In front of one of the big windows on the opposite wall stood a wooden table with white paper arranged on top of a dark red pad. An ink bottle with a dark red quill stood in one corner of the table and a dark red lamp in the other. Gabriel looked at the ceiling. There was a majestic crystal chandelier. It was as tall as one floor. The place looked better than his home. Hell, it even looked better than the suite at the Four Seasons he'd once stayed in. Diana stopped in the middle of the room and turned around. She put her hands behind her back and beamed at Gabriel. Gabriel noticed that she seemed a little nervous. It seemed like she really wanted him to like the place. They'd planned this weekend for over a week, and Gabriel realized that it was supposed to be their special weekend. As he saw her there, standing in the middle of the room, gracious and beautiful, he got really scared. He looked up at the crystal chandelier and gulped. The place made Gabriel feel very small and insignificant. Goosebumps erupted all over his hands and back, and a shiver ran up his spine. The place felt very cold. This was probably due to the forest's climate, thick walls, and his nervousness. "I'll make the fire," he suggested bluntly, and hurried to the fireplace. Diana watched him with a smile on her face. He picked up a few big logs from the woodpile stocked by the wall and put them into the fireplace. He put some smaller twigs on top and some newspaper that was in a compartment by the fireplace and lit it all. He crouched in front of the fire and watched the flames. All the time, he avoided looking at Diana. He felt like a small boy and was getting cold feet. The whole trip suddenly seemed like such a bad idea. It was a huge deal, and he wasn't sure if he was up to it. He wished he was somewhere else at the moment. He could hear Diana approach him from behind, but he didn't dare to turn around. He waited patiently, watching the growing fire, until she ran her fingers against the back of his neck. He could feel the goosebumps on his arms, but didn't move. He kept his eyes on the fire as she ran her fingers all the way into his hair. Slowly, he stood up and turned to face her. He smiled at her, hoping she wouldn't notice his nervousness.
"So, what is our plan for the evening?"
she asked sweetly and stepped closer.
"Oh boy," Gabriel thought and gulped. He was getting more and more nervous with each second. He needed something to calm down, something that would help him to get back on track. Then he got an idea, and he was sure that she would like it. He pulled her towards himself and hugged her tightly.
"I was thinking of a romantic dinner by the fireplace, and then we'll see,"
he whispered into her ear. She put her arms around him and kissed his neck. His stomach growled loudly. She pulled back with a surprised look on her face, and when she saw that he turned bright red from embarrassment, she smiled reassuringly.
"Dinner's a great idea," she whispered. "I am getting peckish."
"I'll heat it up," he said in a much louder voice than he intended and let go of her. For a fleeting moment, her smile disappeared, but then she just winked and let go of him.
"The microwave is in the kitchen," she said,
and motioned towards a door behind Gabriel.
"I will go and change into something a little more comfortable,"
she added with a meaningful look and a seductive smile on her lips. Gabriel watched her as she turned around and slowly walked towards the door opposite the kitchen. She opened the door and looked at him over her shoulder. He stood still by the mantelpiece and watched her every move. She flashed him a smile, and she closed the door after her. He wasn't sure whether he was glad that she'd gone to change. On one hand, he was very curious and excited. On the other, he was nervous. He had butterflies in his stomach. However, now that he was alone, he could gather his thoughts. In a few minutes, she would return in some negligee. His knees got weaker as he imagined Diana in some tiny see-through dress. He leaned against the mantelpiece for support, and his fingers rubbed against something smooth and cold. He turned around surprised, and his gaze fell on a vase standing in the center of the mantelpiece. It had a very classical design with a wide neck and a golden rim that was narrowing down and then widening into a chubby dark green body. It looked like a Greek-style vase, but without any handles. He frowned at the vase. Why would Diana's family keep a vase like this on the mantelpiece? Everything in the room seemed to be chosen for a specific purpose. The whole living room looked like it had been designed for the front page of a prestigious design magazine. There wasn't one piece that didn't fit the place, except the vase. He reached for the vase, but hesitated halfway. He looked at the door through which Diana had left and then at the upper floor. It looked unlikely that she was coming back soon. He threw all precautions aside and picked up the vase. It was much heavier than he'd expected. He lowered it and looked inside. The top was sealed. He frowned and turned the vase upside down. There was no description and no label at the bottom. And then his brain caught up. This was not a vase. This was an urn. He stretched his arms, pulling the urn as far away from his body as possible. His grip weakened and the urn slipped from his fingers. As in slow motion, he watched the urn fall towards the marble floor in front of the fireplace. The ceramic urn hit the floor and smashed into pieces, spilling the ashes all over.
"What was that?"
Diana shouted from upstairs. Gabriel looked up scared and then back at the mess by his feet.
"Nothing,"
he shouted and looked around in panic.
"All right then,"
Diana shouted back while Gabriel located a fireplace scoop with a fireplace broom.
"Just be careful, especially about the urn with my grandma's ashes above the fireplace. I don't care about anything else in that room, but don't pick up that urn."
Gabriel froze with the broom and scoop in his hands, and his heart started to beat even faster. Why the hell had he picked up the urn? He looked at the scoop again and made his decision. He quickly swept some of the ashes onto the scoop and looked at the white living room. He swirled around helplessly, looking for any hiding place for the ashes. He feared that Diana would soon return to the living room. He had to act quickly. And then he spotted the fire. He looked at the ashes in his hand and back at the fire. Without thinking, he threw the ashes into the flames. Even years later, he wouldn't be entirely sure what had happened next. It felt like his brain had taken a vacation at that moment, deciding that it was no longer needed. As Gabriel watched the fire in horror, slowly realizing that he had done something really stupid, the fire diminished as if it was going out. And then it burst out high. Gabriel staggered back in shock, stumbled and fell flat on his back. The broom and the scoop flew from his hands and the remnants of the urn got even more scattered. Out of the corner of his eye, he saw that the flames turned green for a fraction of a second. He wasn't sure if he had imagined that, because when he lifted his head and looked at the fire wide-eyed, the flames looked normal. He lifted himself a little higher, resting against his elbows. With his heart beating painfully in his chest, he watched the fireplace. He realized he shouldn't have done that. And then another rush of panic came. He imagined Diana screaming at him, chasing him with a kitchen knife or throwing plates at him. He imagined her father's dogs chasing him. His imagination supplied a lot of possible outcomes of the situation, each even more fatal to him than the previous one. Then he came up with the best possible solution. He jumped to his feet and ran for the door, not looking back. He smashed the door open and rushed into the night. He pulled out the car keys from his pocket. A beep sounded through the quiet forest, announcing that the car door was open. He nearly smashed into the car as he reached it. He pulled the handle and jumped behind the wheel. He started the engine and stamped on the accelerator while shutting the door closed. The wheels crunched on the gravel as they moved in place for a moment, and then the car bolted out into the dark forest. Gabriel's hold on the wheel tightened as he nearly flew up the road. His brain was still nowhere to be found, and he operated purely on his instincts. As the trees zipped by, he was getting calmer. A few minutes later, he looked at the speedometer and rapidly slowed down from 80 miles per hour to the allowed 35. He shifted the gear, and the stick suddenly loosened and remained in his hand. He looked at it, startled.
"No, no, no," he whined.
He tried to push it back into the position. As he was fighting with the stick, he flicked his eyes onto the road occasionally, making sure he didn't crash. No matter how he tried, the stick wouldn't click back into the stand. Losing his temper, he slammed the stick onto the stand, but nothing happened. He tilted it from side to side in the stand, but there wasn't any position in which the stick would work.
"Don't be broken. Please don't be broken," he said quietly, and pushed the stick further into the stand.
The stick made a satisfying clicking sound and remained in position. He shifted gears and sped up. The stick remained in the stand. He put it in a higher gear and it remained in the correct position.
"Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you," he said with a huge relief and slowed down.
When the surroundings stopped being a blur, he relaxed a little and his brain dared to make a quiet inquiry. The question was simple yet effective. What do you expect will happen next? He had left behind his luggage and his soon-to-be ex-girlfriend and was somewhere in mountains in a forest hundreds of miles away from home with a possibly broken gear stick. Luckily, he had his belt bag with his wallet and documents on the back seat of the car and the phone on the holder in front of him. He was silly, he knew. There was no way he would be able to find a way out of the situation after that ridiculous escape. Yet, he knew he had to at least try. The right thing was to turn around and return. He had to face the music. He had to try and solve it, or at least give Diana a proper closure. Besides, Diana was stranded in the forest. He had to return and take her back to the city, even if he had to endure the 5-hour drive in complete silence. He noticed a wider road further down and decided to turn over there. He switched to a lower gear, and then a strange hissing sound reached his ears. At first, he looked at the trees around him, but he quickly realized that no animals made a sound like that. As he stopped on the place by the road, he looked at the gear stick. Maybe it was broken after all. Then he realized that the sound came from the engine. He looked at the dashboard, but nothing was shown on the display. The hissing sound changed to a loud coughing, and then the engine went quiet. The dashboard turned red, with an exclamation mark in the center, and the car started to beep. Pour water in the expansion tank. Gabriel read the notice, frowning. When the car had started to make that weird sound, he had expected some problem with the gear unit, not the expansion tank. Why do you need water? There should be enough water in you. He leaned back and ran his fingers through his hair. He felt frustrated. It felt like fate or something was stopping him from mending his error. This was supposed to be such a nice trip. Now he was stranded in the middle of a forest with a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.